Factor I can call the most important mental factor in the spiritual path. It is called Amoha. And another name for that is Panindriya, as a faculty which knows the realities as they are. And this is the in terms of spiritual attainment, when we call the liberation of Nibbana. In order to achieve that, what we have to reach is the culmination of this mental state, which is called Amoha. So it can be termed as the most important spiritual faculty in advocating in Buddhism. Faith, effort, mindfulness, concentration, all are developed for the sake of attaining Amoha. In terms of its characteristics, Amoha is the opposite state of Moha. Na Moha becomes Amoha. Na Moha doesn't mean the absence of Moha. It is a mental state which is fully opposite to that of Moha. It's like the light which dispels the darkness. Amoha removes the delusion about the actuality. So this is various in terms of different aspects. In Visuddhi Magga, it's mostly discussed about the wisdom associated with insight meditation. But then you go to Vibhanga and the Suktas and also to Jatakas, you find this wisdom is not only confined to the insight meditation. Its scope is very wide. And we believe that the Buddha attains the highest level of this wisdom, of this faculty, and its culmination is the Buddhahood, in knowing, according to the tradition, knowing everything. Then, in terms of eradicating the kilesas, wisdom, when it reached to the level of Arahatta Magga and Arahatta Pala, the beings become liberated from the suffering forever. Then, if you go to the handout, 5.61, Amoha is the mental state which does not allow Moha to arise and suppresses it. And also, in the end, it completely dispels, right? It suppresses and finally, it completely dispels Moha in higher levels. It is the opposite mental state to Moha. Then it removes the Moha like light removes or dispels darkness. In Vipassana meditation, and also it, the paragraph says that from the third line, out of the two, when Moha arises in the mind, the person becomes unable to apprehend the objects in a correct or proper manner. On contrary, when Amoha is present in the mind, the person observes the objects correctly and properly. What is this correctly and properly? I have explained it in the notes. Correctly means not in a false way. For example, if someone thinks about the heavens as a permanent, everlasting state, this is considering the object in a wrong way. Such wrong considerations, conclusions are arrived with wrong view, ditti we call. But ditti is only possible when there is moha. So moha doesn't allow the mind to take the objects correctly. So that is the point I want to emphasize. Moha doesn't allow the objects to be taken correctly. So it facilitates the arising of wrong view, ideas like wrong view, doubt and so forth. Then the next way is proper manner. Proper way, what I refer to the word proper, it makes the mind to take the objects not in an improper way. It means because the moha is present, the mind reacts with the objects with defilements. That is what I meant here as not proper way. For example, if you take the painful feeling, when we are dealing with the pain, against the painful feeling with the mind occupied by moha, we would dislike it. We would act with anger, right? So we don't understand its true nature. Because according to the Buddhist teachings, there is no any object that should be attached or that should be disliked. Dislike means reacted in terms of anger. There are two types of dislikings. Getting detached or seeing the true nature or the repulsive nature or the suffering of an object doesn't mean the mind is disliked, the mind is occupied by dosa. For example, when you are practicing asubha meditation and vipassana meditation, especially you the defects of the sankharas. But when we are reacting with an unpleasant object with dosa, the domanasa arises and it affects our mind. So in Buddhism, the first way of reacting with the object is accepted. Like you understand the true nature, see the true defects of an object. But if the mind starts to react with dosa, this is an improper way of dealing with the object. So when whatever the object is, if moha is present, it will fall into any of the sides and reacts with the object or act against the object with defilements. Like sometimes it gets attached, sometimes it starts to go against it. So likewise, these defilements are possible when the mind is occupied with moha. So moha doesn't allow the mind to take the objects correctly. So we fall into wrong views, doubts, and etc. And then also the moha makes the mind to deal with the object in an inappropriate way, not a healthy way. So the defilements arises. But when you call it amoha, amoha doesn't allow this. It takes the objects correctly. Correctly doesn't mean that the object is always investigated in terms of realities. So that's why I use the word very carefully here. Moha sometimes deals with concepts, sometimes deals with ideology, sometimes deals with the concepts of beings. So it's not necessarily that the amoha is always investigating the ultimate reality. But whatever the level of amoha is, it doesn't take the object wrongly. That is the point. It doesn't take the object wrong. It doesn't come into wrong idea. Wrong doesn't mean, for example, sometimes because of lack of information, we may think about something or someone with wisdom, but with less accuracy. That is possible. But it doesn't let the mind to take in wrong decisions like the heaven is everlasting, or our soul is transmigrating from mind life to life, there is a self which reacts here, which acts here. So these kinds of wrong interpretations are not possible when amoha is present. And also it doesn't make inappropriate reactions with the object, so the defilements doesn't arise. So it is very safe when the amoha is present, our mind is in a very safe life. So that is what I use as proper way of taking objects and correct way of taking objects. And also in the last line of the first paragraph, it says in vipassana meditation, amoha penetrates into the actual profound characteristic of objects and understands their ultimate nature. It knows the unique characteristics and universal characteristics of objects and understands the true nature. So therefore moha, this is a very brief explanation given about moha, amoha. Anya has a very wide scope. I have translated with two meanings, wisdom or knowledge. Sometimes knowledge refers to the thing that we get through studying, but here I am referring to the exclusive to the amoha or panya. So I have been using these two words without any difference, except in few places, right? When I even say knowledge, I'm not referring to the knowledge of a book. I'm referring to the wisdom or the understanding itself, right? So that is for your easy reference. Then within the tradition, amoha has been introduced with number of synonyms. Some of them are as follows. There are lots of synonyms given for Amoha. They will be useful. Panya, if I read them. Mental state that makes the meanings apparent is called panya. So it makes the meanings of what you have studied, of what you have heard, of what you have learned. So the meanings become apparent. Another definition is chesika, which understands the nature of object in various ways, as object is anicca, dukkha, or anatta. In vipassana meditation, we call it pakarena jana. It knows the objects in various ways. Right? So that is another definition. The sampajanya, mental state which apprehends actual natures of the object in proper and various ways. This is also another definition. Then there are four types of sampajanya. Sattaka, Sapphaya, Gochara and Asamoha. Right? So there are lots of details about that. And which is the mental state which investigates various natures of object. It investigates. So in some traditions you may see, based on these different aspects, I would call them as secondary or sub-characteristics of knowing the object clearly. So these kinds of investigating or knowing with a full apprehension and all this, they can be interpreted as two different chetasikas. But in the end, we are referring to the same action in the mind. So whether we define these actions, secondary actions as two chetasikas or one chetasika, doesn't matter in the end, as long as we know them as mental states or action functions in the mind. So therefore, even the number of chetasikas, ultimate realities, changes with different traditions. As long as we refer to the same kind of mental action, it is not going to be a huge problem. So in the end of the mentality lecture, I'll be explaining what is the criterion to decide the ultimate reality, why it becomes 52 chetasikas. But for example, in some traditions, they have different ways of interpreting the chetasika. For instance, the sati. Sati is a universal mental factor according to Sarvastivadis. Because each and every mind has a nature of, has the ability to recall something. Even the akusala chetasikas, akusala chittas have the ability to recall. So they were referring to this recalling factor, recalling ability of a chitta as a chetasika. So it is not a very huge problem. But then they call the sati, we call in the wholesome side as Theravādians, was named as appamada. So likewise, they have used different terminologies, different ways in looking to the subject. But the main core is, as long as we understand these mental functions, and also we know them as non-self realities, whether you name it as a different chetasika, for example, you name sampajanya and panya as two or one, is not going to affect your practice. As long as we know they are something which happens here and they are not a self, they are conditioned. These are the basic things that we have to knowledge that should be understood. Right? So I'll talk about that at the end of the mentality chapter. Then Dhamma Vichaya, mental state which investigates the noble truths. Another definition. Panditcha, the nature of a wise person. These are the ways to look into the panya. But all these synonyms you will see in definitions, there is the element of knowing. Knowing it correctly, knowing it properly, knowing in a way that defilements doesn't arise. So that these basic qualities are there. Then chinta, mental state which thinks about actual nature such as impermanence, nature of suffering and non-selfness. Then nepunya, the nature of an accomplished person. Then kosala, the nature of a skillful person. So these are all definitions given based on aiming at panya or amoha. Then buri means the earth in Pali, because it has spread in a long, very huge region, a vast region. In the same way, the wisdom spreads upon various objects in terms of knowing them correctly, cognizing them properly. Therefore, wisdom can be called buri. Right? Another terminology is buri sometimes refers to the soft earth, which is without gravel, stones and sand, which is a soft earth. In the same way, wisdom which is not influenced by rough defilements like moha, vichikicca or ditti, which are not influenced by such rough defilements, is also considered as very soft when compared with the defilements. So therefore, wisdom is also called buri because it's like the soft earth. Then another definition is bhute arte ramati ti buri. It means the wisdom, the mental faculty which delights in the actual phenomenon. When we investigate vipassana meditation, there is one occasion. Each and every yogi gets a very strong delight, sukha, piti. So what is the reason for that? When we start to experience a truth that we have not seen directly, clearly, or something we have learned but not experienced. So when I repeat again, when we are seeing an actual reality or a truth that we have not experienced, maybe we have learned it but not clearly experienced, everyone gets a certain kind of an interest or happiness. So that is what happens when a yogi starts to see the rising and falling of sankharas directly. So at that moment, the Buddha mentions, he gets a pleasure, happiness, which transcends even the happiness of a universal monarch. So the wisdom has the nature of delighting. Delighting means it keeps on liking. It has a nature of a certain interest in these actual phenomena. So that's why it was defined. These definitions are mostly secondary definitions. So looking into the word structure, bhute atte ramati, bhu and ra, seeing these two, they have made the definition. Bhute atte ramati bhuri. As long as they doesn't contradict with the fundamentals of the tradition, we can accept these definitions. Most of these definitions are secondary definitions. Mostly they have happened after in councils or afterwards, right? Then medha or mental state which destroyed, medhati hinsati, destroys the defilements. The example is given like a thunderbolt destroys a very huge stone. In the same way, this wisdom dispels, destroys, destructs the defilements such as moha, vichikicca, wrong view, and so forth. And then patoda. Patoda means a stick, as a god. God means not the god, G-O-A-D, god, right? Which is used to control the cattle or the horses. So when a charioteer is riding a cart, when the horses are going astray, going out of the path, the charioteer has to hit the horses with the god and bring them into the correct path. The same way, when our mind is going astray in the akusala side, it's like this wisdom beats us, beats the mind, or shows us this is not proper and brings our mind into the correct path. So likewise, since it beats or spears into the unwholesome mind and brings the mind stream into a correct path, it is called like a patoda. It's given, the name is given patoda. Vijja means the mental state that understands the reality. So these all shows that various aspects of amoha or panya. Then we have some secondary sub-characteristics of amoha. These are all similar type of explanations which are greatly related with our spiritual practice. Yes, sir. I didn't get your question. Which place? Can you please?
Mental state. Main place, you mentioned.
Yeah, mental state is chetasika.
You only refer to chetasika.
Yes, yes, it's a chetasika mental state.
If so, in the first one, panya, you give two definitions.
Yeah.
First one is mental state. Second one, you use Bali word chetasika.
Yeah, same. They are identical. Mental state, mental concomitants, chetasika, all are referring to the same. Because of the repetition, I use the terms as chetasika.
And what is the difference between the first one, panya, and the...
There are two different definitions. So I think it's mainly because when you study something or learn something, the meanings become clearer. Or when you know get to know about a certain object, we can understand what it is. So this kind of clarity is called panya. Sometimes the definitions can overlap. Sometimes definitely, it's not necessarily that these definitions are completely different. It's not necessarily, right?
What does it mean, nepunya?
Nepunya is the nipuna is the person who is accomplished.
Nipuna. What is accomplished?
Accomplished means he has a certain skill and he has accomplished the skill. For example, if I am skilled in writing, right? If I have learned, gone to a certain level, I can say I am a very accomplished person in writing, right? He has reached to a very, very higher level, like a professional level, right? In a certain skill. Nipuna, you call it in Sinhalese, Nipuna means very, very skilled, or when you have reached a certain level, you can call it a Nipuna person, right? Nipunasa bhavo nepunya. This comes as like this. So plus ya kapita. Any other questions to clarify? Shall I proceed with 5.62? A number of sub-characteristics of Amoha related to the attainment of Nibbana have been introduced by the Buddha as an assistant to spiritual practice. All the above definitions are also related to our practice, but these few definitions are within the Bodhipakya Dhamma. That's why I have defined them differently. You know, there are 37 Bodhipakya Dhammas and there are 7 groups. These 37 are divided into 7 groups. What are they? Satipatthana, Sammapadhana, Ittipada, Indriya, Bala, Bojjanga, Magganga, these 7, right? So out of them, Panya can be found in few places. Dhiman Siddhipada. Because investigating wisdom plays a predominant role in our path to liberation. Right? Other than the Virya, Chitta and Chanda, Vimansa also plays as a predominant factor. Right? Then Panindriya. It is impossible to understand the actual nature of realities without the support of the wisdom faculty, hence called Panindriya. Sometimes Indriya can be explained by without which we cannot accomplish certain tasks. For example, believing the existence of phenomena which is beyond the normal human investigation cannot happen. As long as they are truth, as long as they are actual, believing such profound phenomenon happens with the support of a faculty called Sadda. So therefore Sadda is an Indriya in the functioning of believing what is true. Then if you talk about Virya, Virya is the mental faculty which enables the mind stream to sustain without giving up certain tasks till the end. So therefore Virya becomes a faculty. Then we call Sati, the mind stream which is always inclined by nature towards the akusala and is also followed by a latent defilement. Mind stream by nature delights in akusala. That's why Buddha mentioned papasmin ramati mano. The mind always delights in akusala, that is its nature. And it's also another thing is, it's followed by a latent quality called defilements. When these two forces and also the Upanishad that we have done, the habits of past, when all these forces come together, mind stream is naturally inclined towards the unwholesome side. If someone wants to keep this mind stream within the wholesome side, there needs an extra power or extra kind of a force. So it is not possible for the mind stream to remain in the wholesome side without this force. Hence, sati, mindfulness, is an indriya. Because the mind cannot do that act of remaining in the wholesome side without this faculty. The faculty means we cannot accomplish certain tasks, spiritual tasks, without the assistance of certain mental states. Right? Then samadhi, the mind which always likes to go from one object to another, like a monkey likes to jump from one tree to another, always doesn't want to remain in one tree. So likewise, the mind which always delights in various types of objects, If you want to keep it in a particular object and not let it to wander, and to almost to focus on one aspect of the object, there should be we need a certain kind of a focus or a strong mental strength. That is the samadhi. So without this samadhi, mind stream cannot sustain or remain in a certain object. So samadhi becomes a faculty. Then the mind is unable to know the actual natures of the objects, anicca, dukkha, anatta, or the sabhava of the realities, without a clear apprehension or clear investigation or clear understanding. So mind itself is not able to know deeply about these realities. So wisdom is necessary. So it becomes an indriya. It's a faculty, right? So that is how the indriyas are explained in one way. Panya bala. It becomes a strong power or force which can withstand the pressure caused by defilement, such as moha, doubt, wrong view. For example, if you take a doubt, doubt creates a huge pressure in our mind. It always makes the mind to struggle a lot. Only when the panya is present, it can withstand and understand that this doubting is useless, and we can give up that and walk on the correct path without bothering about unnecessary thoughts. So for example, when the doubt arises, it creates a very huge force within our mind. It gives a lot of pressure to us. So even we know sometimes when the doubt is predominant in our mind, it doesn't think in a proper way. So only when the wisdom understands this is not something that I should think, or this is not the way I should think, then this is the understanding of wisdom. So when this wisdom is there, it can withstand the force or pressure generated by doubt, and it is able to suppress and overcome such unhealthy states. So wisdom is a power. The Dhamma Vichaya Sambojjhanga, wisdom which investigates and understands the true natures of reality, is an essential factor in attaining the final derivative, hence called Sambojjhanga. Jojjhangas are the most important factors in attaining the liberation. Then Samadhitti Magganga. Magganga means the means by which our spiritual practice upgrades from one state to another state. For example, with the help of Magganga, we come from the level of Kamavachara to Rupavachara, Rupavachara to Arupavachara, then to Lokuttara. So this kind of gradual development is through the factors we call Magganga. So Panya plays a huge role, and it facilitates. Panya facilitates the sila in the beginning. Panya facilitates the proper thinking in the beginning. So why we adopt the proper thinking and abandon the wrong thinking? In the beginning, we know what is wrong and what is correct. Why we get the faith? Because we understand this person is acting truly, or this person is saying something very, very beneficial. So when we understand that the person is someone trustworthy, like the Buddha or a learned person, then we start to believe the things that he advocates, which are even beyond our apprehension. You can see this in the Chanki Sutta. Buddha mentions how the proper faith towards the Buddha arises. It arises through investigation. A person goes to a renowned teacher and he investigates what he thinks, he listens what he thinks, teaches, and his behavior. Then he finds that it is not, these teachings would reduce my defilements and increase my wholesomeness, and this person also has reduced his defilement to a certain degree, otherwise he cannot expound such a teaching, or his teachings cannot be clearly known with a defiled mind. So likewise, he investigates and understands about the person. Then he gains the faith. This person has fully liberated, or he knows the path correctly, or he is a person who is capable of explaining the path. These kinds of faith starts to. Then, because we as Savakas cannot know everything. Yeah, and beginning as students, we don't know everything. So when we get some faith towards such a person, we start to accept and believe. Not a blind faith, we start to believe that when he says something which is beyond our experience, even we start to accept and believe it. So therefore, real faith in Buddhism is also backed up by investigating wisdom. Then we understand what is correct and what is wrong thinking. Then we abandon the wrong thinking and develop correct thinking. Samma Sankappa also needs wisdom as an initial support. Then why do we adopt our sila and abandon immorality? We understand what is good and bad. So sila also needs the support of wisdom. Then why do we put effort constantly? We know this is going to be fruitful. And then why do we keep on, when we put effort, we get the mindfulness and we get the concentration. So the samadhi faculties are also required and also requires the support of wisdom. Then with this practice, eventually again we get the, finally with the support of samma sankappa, and we get the final type of wisdom called vipassana jnana and the magga jnana. So the path starts from the wisdom and ends with wisdom. Starts with a certain kind of a samma ditti and ends with the attainment of arahatta magga samma ditti. So therefore Buddhist teaching never starts with faith. Buddhist teaching starts with wisdom. You can see this in Chanki Sutta. Why that wisdom, why that faith towards Buddha happens? It's because through the investigation of his teachings and knowing that this person is trustworthy, this what he says makes sense. For then we get the faith. Then we start to listen to him. Then we start to understand what he says. Then we start to get the urge to practice. So this is how the sasana works. So that's why Buddha mentioned samma ditti pure javan. Samma ditti is which runs for is the forum. So therefore these mental states support these like magangas, facilitates sila, facilitates samadhi. Maganga means which facilitates the arising of other spiritual qualities. Wisdom facilitates samma sankappa. Samma sankappa facilitates samma vaca, because we talk having thought. So these, then it supports the sila. Sila, when sila is present, it's easy to have a samadhi, right? The samahito bhikkave yatha bhuta pajana. The one who has samadhi, concentration, the kanika samadhi, he is able to see the actual phenomenon of impermanent suffering and non-self. So maganga means it allows us to go. We don't stop with maganga. Sila maganga supports the mind to come into samadhi maganga. Samadhi maganga supports for the panyama. So likewise, these are means by which we progress. So maganga is for the gradual development of our spiritual practice, right? So hence it's called a samma ditti maganga. Then we have the synonyms of panya we have studied. Some aspects of panya related to the bodhipakkhiya. Done. You have a question? Yes. Okay, so?
So would you please get more evidence from text and support the opinion just how you mentioned Buddha's teaching never started with sadha.
Yeah, so what I was referring to Chanki Sutta. He mentions how a person gets sadha who doesn't have faith in the Buddhist teachings. Sometimes I would say, if I say it never starts, I would take, it's a heavy saying, right? I would say, not never starts. I say, according to the Chanki Sutta, I would repeat my statement. It's because it was a very, when you repeat it, I felt it, the heaviness of the statement. So I would call it, according to the Chanki Sutta, Buddha's teaching starts with wisdom, right? Starts with wisdom. And because you go into Chanki Sutta, you find, you approaches a teacher, and then you find out that how reliable his teachings are. Then you get the faith. Right? This Chanki Sutta.
Majjhima Nikaya.
We are evidence of starting with Pandya.
I think you have read it, right?
Because we also started with Pandya.
Yeah. Thank you, Supra. So what did I say was, the statement was heavy, because if you talk about a Buddhist by birth, right, he starts to get the faith from the beginning. But I consider this faith is not very strong, right? There's always the faith, because there are two types of, if you look at the Chanki Sutta, Buddha mentions about two types of faith. First faith is just sabda, believing what you have heard. So there are five things: sabda, ruchi, akara, parivitakka, ditti nijjana kanti anusam. Saddha is believing what you have heard. Ruchi is you have a preference to a certain kind of ideology. Anusava, you are just have something you have just listened, heard from others. Then akara parivityaka, you have thought about it to a certain level. Ditti nijjana kanti, having thought and having come into conclusions. So what the Buddha's idea is, as long as person doesn't come into the conclusion that my sabda, my anusara, my akara parivitakka, ditti nijjana kanti or ruchi, my belief, my preference, what I have heard, my information, the information I got, the what I have thought and what I have concluded, coming to conclusion, are correct and all the others are wrong. If a person comes into that kind of ideology, he has no progress. So, but as a person, a wise person may say, this is what I believe, this is what I think, this is what I understand, but he always keeps a gap, that there is a possibility, if someone explains me more clearly, that I may change and try to investigate that. So, in the beginning also he mentioned about sadda, he said, just believing what the parents or others says. So, even a Buddhist, in the beginning by birth, he starts to, in a childhood, he starts to believe of the Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha. This still falls into the normal type of a sadda. But I don't say it's wrong. It is, because Buddha says, this sadda in the first stage, it has two ways. It can be correct, it can be wrong. So what does it mean? Even a person with proper sadda means, because when you want to explain about sadda, I explained this in a certain one lecture, because when you want to explain sadda, we come into a position that there are certain phenomena in the world which are actual, which are true. We are not going to verify it. Rebirth is a fact. That's how we explain sadda. Rebirth is a fact. Believing in such a true nature needs a quality called sadda. So we cannot explain sadda with an objective kind of approach. Otherwise, there will be no end. So therefore, Buddha mentions this initial sadda may be correct or may be wrong. So what does it mean? According to him, he is very confident that his teachings are correct. Otherwise, he is not a Buddha. So then he says, your sadda can be correct sadda or sadda can be wrong sadda. But then he explains about, if you read the Chanki Sutta, a second level of sadda. That sadda comes after investigating the teachings and investigating the teacher. Or teacher here referred to the Buddha, today investigating, studying the teachings. So with that known wisdom, sadda comes, sadda jato upasankamati, he approaches and goes forward. He dhammang sunati, or this kind of list starts to happen. Exactly, not the list that I say in Pali. I'm not confident in my memory about the list, but it starts. If we listen to the Dhamma, he starts to investigate the Dhamma. This list starts to come, and finally he goes into the liberation, right? So therefore, when I say the practice doesn't start from sadda, means I'm talking about the second level of sadda, right? The real established faith. So even a person, child born in a Buddhist family, in the beginning he may just accept, because there is no much difference. He accepts the Buddhist teachings. A child in a Christian family, he accepts the God, right? So these just two beliefs. A person becomes a real Buddhist, a well-established Buddhist, only when he studies the Dhamma and understands what really it is. So that's why a Buddhist can be converted into another religion. As long as your faith is not stable, not powerful, it can be influenced and he may give up. So in another sutta, I gave it the reference in the lecture on sabda. Buddha mentioned how could you get a firm sabda that is unshakable. He's not talking about sotapanna. He said, you have to investigate me, my behaviors, my way of talking, my way, how my thinking can be manifested. Then when you keep on investigating, searching whether he has any raga, dosa, moha, can it be observed, and his teachings, then later on he said, you will get a very firm sadda. This is a real enlightened, fully enlightened being. So likewise, so that is the sadda I was talking. So when we actually, we put ourselves deeply into the practice from that level of sadda. So that sadda comes after wisdom, right? So that's why I mentioned Buddhist teaching practices, real practice starts from sadda. And the sutta the Buddha gave in Samyutta Nikaya, when the deity came and questioned, Buddha mentioned, "Pun samma ditti purejan." He never says sadda is purejan, right? He never said mean. Maybe he has mentioned in some places, I'm not aware of that, because I haven't read the completely sutta, all the suttas, but in the samadhi, that sutta he mentions samadhi pure javan. So it means the strong faith comes through investigation. So samadhi, the faith which is before that is not very stable. It can grow into a very strong faith, but also it can be given up at a certain stage sometimes. So that's why I mentioned this kind of explanation, right? Then following varieties of wisdom can be observed within the literature of the tradition. So now we come into a very long list of wisdoms. I think maybe you will feel it's exhausted, a long list. So my purpose was to give you an idea about some information that are scattered in the literature. So it will be thinking that it will be useful, right? So I'll go through them quickly. In this lecture I'll cover a few, right? Because the time is almost. Kammasakata jnana, this is the wisdom which believes about or understands about the karma and its results, right? Karma and its results. In the beginning, we have a rough idea about karma and results, mostly based on the sadda. But when you come to the level of two levels of kanka vitrana visuddhi or the yatha kammupaka jnana, you start to get the full understanding or very deep understanding about the karma. Then jhana samadhi. Jhana samadhi means the wisdom which is associated with jhana. This wisdom is also very important because it is a very high spiritual level. It's a very high spiritual attainment. We don't more normally emphasize on this wisdom in jhanas, but it also plays a huge role because there's full awareness and clear understanding about the object and it suppresses the defilements. Right? Then vipassana samadhi, that we discuss very frequently in our sasana. So it is manifold. What I have given is a certain kind of classification. Namarupa parigraha jnana, understand the natures of namarupa. Namarupa vartana jnana means after apprehending the namarupas, characteristics of namarupa, he comes into conclusions that there is no self other than namarupa. Paccaya parigraha jnana is observing the causes of namarupa. Then kanka vitrana jnana means he comes into the conclusion that there is no transmigrating self from life to life. Sammasana jnana is the wisdom which applies the three universal characteristics upon realities and contemplate them as anicca, dukkha and anatta. Then udayabhya jnana is the wisdom which sees the rising and falling of sankhara. Magamagan jnana jnana means the wisdom which knows what is the correct path and wrong path, and also which overcomes the attachment towards the upakkilesas, the very mysterious or type, a very strange types of spiritual experiences we get with the udayabhya jnana, like a light for some yogis, and strong bliss, wisdom, effort, spiritual experiences which excites us. So there is a subtle attachment towards this. So with the magga magga jnana jnana, we overcome these attachments, conceits or wrong views, and also knows what is the correct path and what is the wrong path. So that is a very important wisdom. Vipassana jnana, starting from the strong udayabhaya, banga jnana, bhaya jnana, ādīnava, mudibhida, munchito kamyata, patisankha anupassana, sankhāra upekkha, anuloma, up to these lokiya jnana, till anuloma jnana. They grow, they one after one, they gradually grows. They are all can be called vipassana jnana. Then we come into gotra bhu jnana, which transcends the sankharas and observes the nibbana directly for the first time, but which doesn't dispel the kilesas permanently, which only reduces the strength. So this will be a separate jnana, gotra bhu. It doesn't fall into any of the visuddhis. Then after all, we get the, in the next moment, the magga jnana, which observes the nibbana directly and also eradicates the kilesas permanently. Right? So, and also this magga jnana can be called kaya jnana and also dhamme jnana. Right? These are two synonyms for magga jnana. Right? Then, in the above list of various types of wisdoms, nama rupa parigraha jnana, nama rupa vavartana jnana, pachaya parigraha jnana, and kanka vitrana jnana collectively are called jnata parigraha. Then sammasana jnana belongs to tirana parinya, starting from the vipassana jnana is starting from the strong udayabhaya, gotra bhu jnana and magga jnana are all belong to the ahana parinya. So these are the another way of explaining. They are also representing the wisdom. They are classified, the above wisdoms are classified into three groups according to the vipassana practice in the tradition, right? Because they lessen the kilesas and eventually eradicates them, right? Tirana parinya means it understands what as it comes into conclusion as anicca, dukkha, and anatta. Phalanyana, wisdom associated with supramundane fruition that tranquilizes the mind stream. Patipassadipa. This is also called anupade jnana. You have to add it can also be called dhamme jnana. So dhamme jnana has two meanings. It can be magga and wisdom associated with magga and also phala. I couldn't do it, so dhamme jnana is another synonym. Phala jnana has another meaning called dhamme jnana. Then we come into paccavekkhana jnana, contemplating, reflecting knowledge. So after someone has attained a very high spiritual attainment, normally in Buddhism, a thing which I personally appreciate a lot, in Buddhism, we have a practice of taming our bodily and verbal improper behaviors, and taming our bodily and verbal actions, and taming our mind, that is called sila, taming our mind with samadhi, and understanding the true natures of the reality, that is called phala, and a full liberation, that is called understanding is called through vipassana jnana and getting into the magga jnana, which is wisdom, and also which eradicates the kilesas. It means starting from sila, we tame our bodily and verbal actions, we tame our mind, and then understand the actual nature of the reality, eradicating the kilesas, and we get liberated. Liberated means from the defilements, we call it phala, and also we get the liberation from all the suffering, nibbana, liberation from suffering. Then it doesn't stop there. Then what happened? The person who has attained that level gets to know that he has fulfilled sila, samadhi, panya and got liberated by himself. So that is what I feel as a very nice aspect of Buddhism. When a person became a noble being, Buddha doesn't need to say you have become a noble. He knows it by himself. So it is a practice that leads to not only stops in faith, also with practically taming ourselves, understanding the true nature, and it's not just for a philosophical satisfaction, getting rid of the defilements of suffering means the liberation, and knowing, and if you can evaluate by yourself or get to know by yourself that you have walked upon this path and got liberated. That is called paccavekkhana jnana. This jnana, this stage is called vimutti jnana dasana. So we have the sasana can be put into five aspects: sila, samadhi, panna, vimutti, and vimutti jnana dasana. Vimutti Jnana Dasana. Vimutti Jnana Dasana means Pachavikarana. This is Phala, Phala Chitta. Right? If I write them in terms of realities, this is Phala. Loputra Phala Chitta. Then this is Vipassana Jnana. Speaking proper words, doing proper actions, and living a proper life with people. Right? So these are the aspects of our sasana. So this, the last stage, Pachavikana. This last stage is the conformity that confirms that
have to. Okay, why no Khanika Samadhi?
Sorry?
Khanika Samadhi.
Normally, yeah, this is the way it is explained. You can put Khanika, because Vipassana is always associated with Khanika Samadhi. Right? Vipassana is always associated with Khanika. So this is just a different department. Right? Which you, when you have the Vipassana Jnana, it means you have Khanika Whether you are a samatayanika or vipassanayanika, it doesn't matter. Your vipassana meditation is always with khanika samadhi. Khanika samadhi means samadhi which breaks at the bhavanas. It's momentary. You focus on the reality, you understand anicca, you understand the dukkha. So there are two samadhi, two types. Apara samadhi is like one stream, it keeps on. Upachara samadhi also breaks, but it's with one object. Right? You cannot do vipassana with upachara samadhi. You cannot do vipassana in apanasa. You do vipassana always with khanika samadhi. Even you get out of the jhana and do vipassana, your samadhi is khanika samadhi. So this vipassana, pachavekana jnana belongs to vimutti jnana dasana. This is the place you confirm that you have attained. And in suttas we have heard, kina jati, usitam brahmacharya, tatam karaniya, naparangitattahaya, pajana. So these are all about the Pachavekana jnanas are not only reflecting on magga and phala. The scope of Pachavekana jnana is very huge. We only talk about magga and phala. It considers about your liberated nature. It considers about the, I have explained that, about the, in the paper. Sometimes it explains, it starts to generalize your understanding. Whatever anicca, dukkha, anatta, whatever the natures of the are common to, past, present, future, all the 31 realms, he applies, he generalizes a noble being. So they are all called Pachavekana. Right? So Pachavekana Jnana also confirms that you are attained. Right? So I'll stop with the Pachavekana Jnana. So these Pachavekana Jnanas are the reflecting knowledges. It is threefold. Actually, it is fourfold, but here I will mention it as threefold. What are those? Jnana Pachavekana Jnana, you have attained absorption, samatha absorption, you come out of it and you reflect the jhana factors. Then magga, Lokuttara Dhamma Pachavekana Jnana, after you attaining magga pala, you come out of, suddenly you reflect on the magga, pala and nibbana. So it's called Lokuttara Dhamma Pachavekana. Another Pachavekana Jnana is Kilesa Pachavekana. Kilesa Pachavekana is you contemplate, a noble being contemplates about the kilesas which have been eradicated and remnant kilesas. This jnana is exclusively based on your scriptural knowledge. That's why the Mahanama Sakya, the Sakyan king, the Mahanama, after Siddhartha left the palace, Nanda was going to be the king. And he also became a monk. Buddha made him to be a monk. And Rahula, the heir to the throne, was also a monk, according to our tradition. Then it was, and also the Sakyan, the one was left was called Badia, right? He became a king. So he also became a monk. Then the throne went to Mahanama. It is one of Buddha's cousins. Mahanama Sakyan is Anuruddha's elder brother, Venerable Anuruddha. Mahanama Sakyan was a Sakadaga. In one sutta, you find Mahanama goes and asks the Buddha, what sort of kilesas remain in me? Because he had a wrong scriptural knowledge. He thought, Sakadagami Magga completely abandons Kamaraga and Dosa. Right? So while he is traveling in that road, he sometimes gets certain sensual feelings and also mind gets agitated or get dosa because of some unpleasant behaviors. Then he had a problem. He had no doubt about his attainment, about his Sakadagamihood. He knows he has seen the Nibbana directly two times and eradicated kilesas for two times, but he thought his defilements, Kamaraga and Patika, completely abandoned. Then when they arise, he got into a dilemma. What is going on? Right? He had no doubt about his attainment. Then he asked the Buddha a question. What sort of defilements are remaining in me? If you go into the footnote, it says... If you go to footnote 1.44, Tassa maiham bante evam hoti. Kosu nama me dhammo ajjattam appahinu. Yena me ekada loba dhamma apichittam pariyadayati. Dosa dhamma apichittam pariyadayati. Moha dhamma apichittam pariyadayati. What sort of dhammas are remaining within me? So because sometimes my mind is accompanied by loba, dosa and moha. Right? So why this doubt came to him? Because of this third pachavekkana jnana, kilesa pachavekkana jnana is based on your scriptural knowledge. Right? The second pachavekkana jnana, it is a direct experience. You don't need scriptural knowledges for that. You directly knows what you have attained. Right? So that is the difference. First one, jnana pachavekkana jnana, sometimes this jnana pachavekkana, just remove the, remove means, when I now, jnana should be there because we are talking about wisdom. When sometimes the jnana pachavekkhana, without the jnana, it says when the jnana, you have mastered the jnana, sometimes the pachavekkhana reflection can happen without wisdom. So jnana pachavekkhana. But the lokuttara dhamma pachavekkhana, I have written in that handout, in the lokuttara dhamma pachavekkhana, the wisdom should always be there. Then there is another type of pachavekkhana jnana which has a different functioning. For that, see under pachavekkhana jnana, anvaya jnana. Pachavekkhana, I have given the number, right? So these are the points I would like to discuss in this lecture. So the next lecture, I'm going to cover the remaining part for this handout regarding fun. Yes, you have a question, you can ask.
Why he has no doubt about his attainment?
Because he directly knows about his attainment. After someone attains the Maggapala, normally he observes his attainment, he records his attainment. It's like, for example, you see something from the eyes and you're with mind, though you understand what it is. You see that through a divine eye, a certain object, from other minds, you analyze what it is. In the same way, after someone had an experience, a very sudden experience of Nibbana, of seeing that very perfect object, his mind starts to recall what it is. Yes.
There are some people, they saw that they have already person, but actually they didn't. Somebody maybe saw
their
Arahant, but actually they didn't.
So it's like this. I'll give you a direct answer like this. If someone has a doubt whether he's a Sotapanna or not, he's not a Sotapanna. Right? If someone has a doubt whether I'm Arahant or not, he's not a Sotapanna, he's not an Arahant. So a person who has really attained has no doubt at all.
I mean, somebody saw that they have already.
But there is a if they
has already become Arahant.
Yeah.
But actually, they are not.
Right. So that can be the Adhimana. They have, which Buddha also mentioned, some believe them as Arahants, but they are not Arahants. That is a very pitiful case because they are not Arahants and they have no idea that they are not Arahants. That is one case. Sometimes they think they are Arahants, and they say they may have a doubt. It means they are not Arahants. The one who has really attained the Nibbana Noblehood, he would never get the doubt. Any other questions? One question? So we'll conclude and we'll go to the next.